Coming to you from the all-new Live House in Hollywood, California.
Hey everybody, welcome to this week's episode of Pensado's Place, and what an episode it is. Our good friend Keith Urban's in the house. Really quickly before we get to Keith, our buddies at BandPay, an incredible app that helps you with financial management, hitting milestones, getting paid. We're going to start a Twitter campaign with them next week where some of you are going to get selected to receive money to use the app. Details on that next week. For what BandPay is, check this out.
Look, I don't know if anyone's told you, but the music industry has its own payment tool, BandPay. With BandPay, you'll never have to ask or wait to get paid. You'll create agreements that act as a contract, quote, and invoice all in one. And because BandPay will collect the funds before the project starts, you'll get paid after every project milestone. That means no more chasing down payments. Imagine guaranteed paydays and securing every bet. Okay, now stop imagining it. Download BandPay, available on Android and iOS.
So if you would, like and subscribe, sign up to our newsletter, hit us on our socials. And now, this week launches his brand new album, The Speed of Now, Part 1. He is a great guy, and we're pleased to bring him to you. Here's Keith Urban. The accolades run wide and deep. You can put everything in it, Grammys and Entertainer of the Year and CMAs and big tours and big singles and big records. You might not know about all the charity stuff he does, but I tell you what we feel. This is a superstar performer, entertainer, producer, but even more importantly, a superstar human being. Welcome back to the place, the one, the only, wow. Keith Urban.
Thank you, man. Bless you. How are you, Dave? It's nice to be back with
Keith,
you again.
Good. How about you, buddy?
Really good. Nice to be back with you both. Good. Everybody's good. As good as can be. Right. Yes.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Man, you know, in listening to the record, the there's so many things that come through. But one of them that comes through from my perspective, and Dave and I talked about this, is just your absolute penchant for crushing boundaries. You throw everything in and decide, when you listen to this particular Keith album, which we'll talk about for sure, almost every genre is touched in a kind of cool way, but it comes back to this central Keith core. It all feels like you, but you incorporate lots of different stuff. Is that intentional? Is that just your musical wanderlust?
Yes, my musical wanderlust, yeah. It's I was raised with a father who's a drummer. Mm. My grandfather was a piano player and teacher his whole life. So percussion, rhythmic percussion energy and sonics and everything is deep in my DNA. And I think that's what's always been the connection between everything that I gravitate towards, is a sense of rhythmic energy. It's, you know, it's universal and it transcends everything.
Mm-hmm. It feels to me like the groove and the lyrics on this record are just a step above some of the more current work. It's like your grooves are just infectious. And we were provided a lyric sheet, and the lyrics are incredible. Every single person, I was touched by so many of the lyrics. I just want to give you a compliment on that, and then also want to give you a compliment on Nile Rodgers and Pino Palladino, who Pino's like, oh my God, that's my favorite bass player ever. Yeah. But Niles, I know you're a big fan of Nile Rodgers, I know you're a big fan of his too. And so the groove on that song is out of sight, man. Great stuff.
Thank you.
I listened to the record probably, I listened to every single song on the record probably 5 or 6 times. If I had more time between the time I got the mixes, I would have done more, but like Herb said, there's something about this record as opposed to the last record that you seem more sure of yourself. It's more confident. The players, of course, best players on earth. I'm not blowing smoke up your skirt. It really is a great record, Keith. And that comes from a musician and an engineer. So
Thank you.
Actually, you opened up a door that I wanted to go down, because the collaborations, how you choose who you work with, obviously now Rogers, Pink is just, there's nothing that she doesn't get on that she doesn't sound natural to, yeah, in my opinion.
Yeah.
How did the Breland thing come about? You read something about him and then contacted him. What was that story?
Yeah, I read an interview with him. I heard of him last year when he did a song called My Truck. Mm. And, you know, that sort of genre disregarding fusion is right up my alley. Mm-hmm. And then I read an interview with him earlier this year online, and I was fascinated by him. Mm-hmm. And so I just got a hold of him. I just got his phone number from somebody and just called him out of the blue. And we talked for like 45 minutes, mm-hmm, about music and everything. And I just went, this is a kindred spirit right here. You know, it'd be really fun to see what happens if we get in a room to write together and record, just create, you know, get in the sandbox, start making stuff. Mm-hmm. And he was in Atlanta. This would have been a Wednesday night. And I said, man, if you're ever in Nashville, I got a studio at the house. Just be great to just come. And he goes, I'll be there Friday morning. And sure enough, I'm like, okay,
let's go.
I said, 10 o'clock. Is that good? He goes, yeah, I'll be there at 10. My phone rings at like 9:15. He goes, bro, I'm out front of your house. I'm like, what the hell? He goes, that drive was way quicker than I expected from Atlanta. I'm like, you drove from Atlanta? You know, I love this guy. And we just went at it. We got in the studio and we started talking about songs, and then we worked on something. We wrote this thing, which ended up being for his project. And then we wrote a song called Soul Food the next day, and we brought in a couple of other guys he likes writing with, Sam Sumser and Sean Small. Mm-hmm. And I came at this idea of what became Out the Cage, which is the opening track on the record. Yeah. And it was born of the sort of 90s English drum beat, breakbeat groove, like Prodigy and Fatboy Slim and that kind of stuff, like Firestarter and those sort of things. I love that energy, you know, again, drumming and then just intoxicating energy. And that stuff makes me want to like either punch somebody or like break speed limits or something, but it jacks me up. And I'm like, I got to figure out how to bring that thing into my world. And brought that song idea to those guys. And then Breland said, what about Out the Cage? And then, of course, you know, going through all the lockdown confinement that we'd all been going through was the obvious starting point for the song. Yeah. But there was the protests going on. There was everything going on. And so that song just was very immediate for us to write.
Out the Cage and The Speed of Now, both those are very timely in terms of where we are now. Was that a conscious, were you aware that's what you were trying to do, like give us an insight into these times right now? Because that's kind of what
it wasn't from this. Yeah, it wasn't intentional. You know, it's a little bit like when someone goes, you push boundaries. And I go, I never think of it in terms of pushing boundaries. I think of it in terms of not stopping myself from going to a place. So it's actually not this, it's just this. Like, don't get in the way of yourself. And if I'm interested in something, just go there. Why not? You know, just see if it works. If it doesn't work, no one will ever hear about it. And maybe it'll work. And that was a big part of making this record for sure.
And that's how the records feel. They feel this album, most of your albums do this, but this one really does it. It feels free. Like, I'm actually amazed at the editing process, knowing how you like to start with your kitchen messy and go through the process that's complex. And then there's got to be good editing at the end of it to turn it into those jewels that people can consume, but keep the integrity of the lyric and the music. Do you do that editing process yourself? You got a couple of badass Dans with you, McCarroll and Huff, you know.
That's great. Yeah.
You know, how does the process work?
Yeah, that's a good question. it's a balancing act of of not tinkering with it so much that it loses its truth and spirit,
mm-hmm.
but also that it just is cohesive, you know, trying to glue all these kind of things together that are coming from very different places. A song like Out the Cage, Live With, or Tumbleweed, or just they're kind of coming from very different places. I mean, I guess for me, I put it together like a set list, like a live set list. You know, well, I got 14, 15 song set list. I know a lot more songs than that, but I can't do all them. I've got to narrow it down to these. What's the journey I want to go on? How do I want to open the show? How do I want to close it? And where do I want to go in between? Is really the starting process. But yeah, the editing, whittling stuff down and narrowing it down. I find sometimes in the overdubbing with songs, a lot of the time, I've learned that a lot of the time, the last bit of the process is undoing lots of shit.
Yeah.
You know, I think it was Karl Lagerfeld that said, before you leave the house, you should take off one accessory. Right. You'll probably have one thing too many on.
Too much, yeah.
Get rid of that. And there's something about record making that I'm finding very similar. It's just removing certain things because it's gotten too crowded.
I'm really surprised at myself for liking God Whispered Your Name, Pino Palladino's playing on it. I can't forget the guy. I can't remember the guy's name, the gentleman's name that played the Wurlitzer, but I love the Wurlitzer part. And that's my favorite song on the whole record. And if you know a little bit about my background, starting out in South Florida with a bunch of rednecks who ended up having some of the greatest bands ever, I'm really surprised. But there's something about that song that maybe it's my age, maybe it's my... I don't know what it is, but it spoke to me really, really, really hard and really good. It's my favorite song on the record. I kept playing it and playing it and playing it. But the sequence was really good. I hope that's preserved throughout the life of the album, because the sequence is excellent. And
thank you.
And you don't see that too much these days because of the lack of the opportunities for an album to take root, you know? But I hope people listen to it in sequence. The sequence wasn't accidental. Great stuff.
Definitely not accidental, no. God Whispered Your Name. I'm so glad you love that song. It was an opportunity I had to work with the late, great Ed Cherney, who I've been an admirer of for so many years. And Dan McCarroll, who you mentioned, who's a co-exec producer on the record with me, said, hey, would you want to work with Ed? And I'm like, yes. Absolutely, I want to work with Ed. And he said, all right, I think we can put a session together out in California. And I said, I have this song called God Whispered Your Name. I think it'd be great to do with a really good band. And so we handpicked Matt Chamberlain on drums and Pino on bass. Yes. And then he said, I could get Ben Montench to play keys. I'm just like, this day just gets better and better. And that's how we ended up doing it. We had me and Matt, Pino, Benmont on the floor, and then Ed at the console. It was so magical, and I was dying to do more songs with that exact team, and we lost Ed far too soon, man.
Far too soon, far too quick. It's one of the things that industry still is trying to get over. You know, not to take it to that kind of place. And speaking of that, which I was going to bring up later, but we do it now. I also remember just how much Busby with you was such a magical combination. And I thought about him listening to this record, just something about his spirit being around. So just shout out to Busby and he's gone on before us. Really amazing. I will also say this too, just for the men, you know, I got to give a little brother thing here. If you need a female anthem that you should just really give into, Ain't It Like a Woman, just listen to that lyric and just give in, just cop to it. Cause that's the truth, brother. That is the truth.
Right on. So
it's phenomenal. Do you end up with a favorite on it or favorites for different reasons?
Yeah. Favorite for different, every one of them. I mean, that's a huge part of choosing the ones that actually make it into the lifeboat, as it were. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what it feels like when I'm trying to determine which songs actually end up on the record, because I record far too many, you know, maybe 30 plus songs, and I've got to now bring it down to 14, 15 songs. And it feels like who gets to be in the lifeboat, who doesn't, who makes it. And that's why this record became part one, because I went, well, I want everybody in the lifeboat. And oh, well, just need more lifeboats, you know? So, so I got part one and part two. I already built a boat for the other guys. But different songs for different reasons. And then, of course, once we start playing live,
yeah,
it takes on a whole new life of its own too, yeah.
Dan Huff, just speak about that unbelievable talented dude.
Yeah, crazy great. I mean, we've worked together now for, man, it's going to be coming up near 18 years, 20 years, coming up close to 20.
Wow.
I recorded we recorded a lot of stuff before we got down to the ones that I felt were really working for the record. Was the first one that we kept from that session. And then the song called Forever really fit the record. So we kept all of that. And again, it was, you know, something like Forever was so fun to do because it's real. It was a real deal, real band, you know, drums, bass, guitar, keyboards, everybody on the floor really playing and capturing that vibe of a real band. It was the perfect song to do that. And Dan is great in the studio for keeping all that, you know, moving in the right direction.
You said something that's going to stick with me the rest of my career. And you said you always only look for what it is, but for what it isn't. In other words, you look for the things you don't like as opposed to the things you like when you're creating. Can you expand on that a little bit? Because I want to get it right. Because it feels to me there's something organic and correct about that, particularly as a mix engineer. I take notes so that I won't ruin what I like, and then I take notes of what I don't like.
Wow. And then everyone's got their process, Dave.
Yeah.
Yep.
I just I realized that as just creative people, all of us, when we're building something, creating something, whether it's a mix, whether it's a recording, a song, whatever we're doing, but particularly in the recording process, I find I have something in mind for this thing. Like, there should be a word called audialize, which is, you know, like you can hear it before it exists.
Yeah.
So yeah. I can audialize a song or a record before it's finished. You know, certainly a case of Out the Cage, I audialize that completely in my head, and then trying to get that to come into, to be manifest was really difficult. I think the frustration for me as an artist is that I am hearing whatever it is I'm doing, I'm hearing it for what it isn't. So if I hear a mix back and I've got an idea of what I wanted, I hear everything that isn't that. Mm-hmm. And I don't really hear it for what it is. And that's probably why as artists, we're constantly frustrated because we hear it for what it isn't. And only somebody else listening without any bias, no preconceived anything, they're the only people that really hear it for what it is. And that's why that feedback is so important. And it's not till years later that I hear a song on the radio. And it might be 5-6 years later, I hear a song of mine on the radio and I'm like, oh, I really like that. Oh, I get it. Right. Because I've long forgotten what I was trying to do with that song. That's really the first time I get to hear it for what it is.
When you have a finished product in your head, coming out of the speakers isn't coordinating with what's in your head. That's what it isn't. You know what I'm saying? I guess that's where it comes from. But, I have the same problem when I finish the mix. It's what I want. But when you ask me to do a tweak, you're asking me to make it worse in my own mind, and I'm not going to do it.
Of course, yeah.
Oh man.
Oh, because it's all subjective too. It's subjective, and you know, one of the things someone asked me, well, do you play these songs for people to get feedback and opinions, and whose opinion matters when you're playing something? Is it your wife? Is it your manager? Is it, you know, Dan McCarroll? Who do you play things for? More and more I've realized it's less about who I'm playing it for, and it's more about how I feel playing it for this person.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's really the barometer that's truest for me as an artist, is like, is this what I was trying to do? That's really the most important thing for me. And so I play a song for my wife and she may go, I can tell she's like, kind of likes it, but it's a bit tepid, but I may really love it. And I'm like, I feel good about this, you know? Or she may hear a song and go, I love this song, but I'll be sitting there going, I don't feel good playing this for you. And why did I not feel good playing this for you? At what part did I suddenly feel a little gutted? And then let me look at that, you know? That's the barometer I realize is equally important for me right now.
You know, it's interesting that you said that, because I found, you know, we do these things, and obviously you've done a ton and we've done a ton. There's the process of all the representatives getting you all the material, and you listen to it technically, and you, you know, research stuff because you don't want to look stupid when you're having a conversation. And then I got past that phase and I was just listening. And then I was listening loud, which is always a good sound, good sign. I was bouncing through things. I sort of got away that in, you know, 2 hours I was going to be interviewing, and I was just grooving. Because see, you know, what a lot of people don't know, you and Dave talked about it in real cool musical terms, but your secret funkster comes through in your records all the time. Yeah, there's a funky boy there all the time, and I can always find it. And
that's high praise, Herb. Thank you.
Oh no, it's just such a good thing. And then the other thing that I also observe about you, and this is going to sound a little odd, but I love this. So you're at so many award shows and so on and so forth, and obviously the camera goes to see how you're reacting, right? And I came up in a label where live performances were critical, like it was a science. Mm. You know what I mean?
Right.
And when you are seeing a performance that takes you to that place, man, if anybody ever wanted to see heaven on somebody's face, it's going to cut to you, and you are just, you're both, it looks to me like you're both enjoying it, and the front man guy who performs and interprets songs for millions of people around the world, that brain is turning too. And it's just such a joy. And one in particular was CMA's 2015, Justin Timberlake and Chris Stapleton.
Oh, God.
I play that like it's a national anthem, but watching you do it.
Because you knew you're witnessing something extraordinary. You're like, what the holy shit. This comes along really, this comes along rarely, these moments, you know, because half the time collaborations are kind of shoved together by the producers of TV shows, and they go, let's jam this person with that person, and they don't really get along, they don't really have anything in common, and it's just awkward, you know. It's good on paper, and then it just sucks on the stage. Those two cats, man, golly. So just sort of common thread manifest of those two worlds that just met in this soul place of just beauty and power and elegance, and God, it was great. It was everything great. That moment
for me, Keith, was Old Town Road with Billy Ray Cyrus, and you're paying that damn ganjo, and so I'm sitting there watching that, and you're like just in heaven, and I'm like, don't do a solo, please, Keith, don't do a solo. You ripped off a solo on a banjo on a hip hop song, and it was great. It was really great. And afterwards, I could see in you, because I'm a guitar player too, and I could see a sense of satisfaction that I nailed that. And you played a little louder the rest of the song after that too. By the way,
I might have been faking that look. I don't know. I don't know if I feel that. But it was surreal to be playing that song with those guys, you know, and especially to be playing it at a stadium full of people. It's just like the insane. That song's magical.
I kept thinking Billboard's going to put it back on the country chart if you got through with it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. You know, but what a great example of just absolute free, liberated creativity that didn't fit anywhere and belonged everywhere.
Exactly. Exactly. We're always telling people, push the envelope. Like, what? Don't, in basketball terms, we call it self-checking. Don't self-check. Right. Go. And and don't just stay where you're comfortable. Go where you're uncomfortable and put that jacket on and see how it fits you. You're going to come up with something new and amazing and interesting. And if you don't, you're just regressing to the mean. If you're creative, you don't want to regress to the mean. You want to do your thing.
Yeah. And it's, well, you also want to stay excited about what we do. And someone asked the other day, you know, how do you stay in that place of creativity and adventure and all this other stuff? And I go, one of the words that I feel like everyone forgets in our business is play. The first word. We play guitar, we play drums, we play music, we play a show, we play a record, we fucking play. Yes. Like, when did we lose the fun, right? You know? And that's one thing I'm trying to really make sure never gets lost in the midst of it all. It's just play. It's maybe it'll work, maybe it doesn't, but man, just get in the sandbox and start building shit. See what happens.
Absolutely.
Keith, can you do me a favor? I love hearing stories about musicians, and I was drinking some coffee, which I get from my family in Spain, and I spit all over myself when you told this story. Your manager got you a couple of supposedly free tickets to fly on an airline, and then you had to fly into this really tell that story, man. That's the greatest story ever, especially when you were standing on the felt and not on the actual, you know what. Tell that story.
Yeah, that's in the that's probably in the worst gig ever file, right? My manager at the time, this was in Australia. I don't know when it was, early mid-90s, somewhere around there, mid-90s probably. He said, we got a deal on some airline tickets, which we're going to get comped if we just do a gig at the airport. And I'm like, okay, that sounds pretty good, you know. Yeah. What airport? And say, this is tiny little airport, little regional airport. I'm like, okay, that sounds pretty good. So we get to the airport this day, my three-piece band, and it's a tiny little airport, one baggage carousel, right? That's how small it is. And I'm like, so where do we set up? And the airport manager goes, just over here. And he leads us over to the baggage carousel. And you guys know the baggage carousel always goes around. And then there's a little carpeted area raised up above the where it goes around. He goes, you're going to set up there on that strip of carpet. I'm like, okay. So like this tiny little strip of carpet. So we set up little bass drum and the snare. And then Jerry was on bass and then I was on guitar and we put the amps somewhere else because there was no room up there. So we're standing up there looking like complete idiots and we're sort of sound checking. And I said, all right, well, when do we start playing? Guess we'll start now. I'm like, well, there's nobody here. He goes, you start playing, I'll show up. I promise you. And I'm like, okay. So we start playing. Sure enough, couple of guys come over and then some lady comes over and a few more people come over and I'm like, all right, this is kind of a good gig. And we're right in the middle of it. Next minute, I'm like, that's what the club is there for. And they all grab their bags and just walk off and people are leaving and we ended up with nobody. So I'm like, fuck this. And I had a wireless guitar and I just sat on the conveyor belt and just playing guitar and just rode around on the conveyor belt. I thought we were killing it, but they just wanted their money.
Before the good stuff, the humbling stuff comes.
I still have a little PTSD when I see that little carpet.
I bet. Here's another question for you. Now, in God Whispered Your Name, were you perched on that rock or was that Hollywood magic?
I was perched on that rock.
It looked like. How did you get there? That dangerous.
I just crawled up there. That was a weird shoot because the standing on the rock was one thing. This was the God Whispered Your Name shoot. Standing on the rock was one thing. It's much hard. I discovered it's very hard to kind of rock out on a boulder and not lose your balance, but kind of not make it look like you're terrified. Yeah. But actually more terrifying on that shoot was it was in this place called Lancaster in California, just on the outskirts of this city of Lancaster. And beautiful, you know, boulders and just desert, fantastic. And they had some drones above with cameras for the filming and stuff like that. And the director said, if you just like walk on this path and then just like walk off the path and just walk off into the distance. And there were signs saying, beware of rattlesnakes. I'm like, are these old signs? And they're like, oh, no, that's the rattlesnake wrangler over there, just off camera. I'm like, right. And she's going, so you just walk off into the bushes and stuff. I'm like, yeah, I'm not walking off the path here, you know. Wow. I wasn't doing that for a video or for anything. There was a rattlesnake wrangler just off camera. It's absurd.
I'd rather have a luggage carousel.
yeah, absolutely.
For sure. Record comes out. The process generally is it does what it does. And then now with this new circumstance, what do you do about live appearances?
Yeah.
Who knows?
Who knows, man? You know, I feel for all of us, the audience included. I mean, and all the crew and vendors and just infinite millions of people that are unemployed just in our industry alone, you know. I don't know when this comes back, how it comes back or anything, but I'm a little lost on that front. I'm surprised that I finished my record because I think I was just going to live. I think I was going to turn the studio into my bunker and just keep working on the record until this all went away.
Absolutely.
You have
finished the record and I'm like, normally you start thinking about a tour, and I knew there was no tour to be thinking about. So I just kept dragging my feet, finishing the record.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have fun at the one you did at the drive-in a couple of months ago with the, with some of the medical teams and some of the people that were, you know, putting their life on the line for us? I think you had about 200 people, and you were on a flatbed truck, which seemed appropriate, Nashville.
Yeah.
Was that fun? I mean, you think you'd do another one?
It's a different experience. It's a different experience. It's no regional airport baggage carousel. It's pretty damn close. In theory, it was great on paper, because when the idea got floated, you just went, oh yeah, of course, you know, you go to every concert and we have a massive video wall behind us and people are out front. And I'm like, oh, there's already a pre-built video wall, put a stage at the foot of that. All the cars are facing in the right direction. Even with the sound system, we can tap into the FM frequency thing that they use at the drive-ins, and this would be great, you know. And got it, walked out on that flatbed truck to those cars, and it was surreal. I wasn't sure if I was going to be playing to a whole bunch of cars where I couldn't see people. You know, like out of a scene from that animated thing Cars, you know, like I was going to see Mater in the distance. but it actually ended up being more of a tailgate party. Everybody was on the roof, they were on the hood, they were on the backs of their pickup trucks, and they weren't in the car. So it was actually, that part of it was really fun. But I mean, there's no substitute for a mosh pit. There's no substitute for that energy.
You can't get the energy, man.
Instead of clapping, did they just blow their horns?
There was a lot of all of that. Yeah, a lot of that. And people kind of coming down the front anyway, and you're kind of like, oh, guys, you know. I chuckle at some of the ways that I see them trying to work stuff out, like with the socially distanced little pods that I've seen, you know, different kind of concerts and stuff. Because my first thought is, even a drive-in situation, my first thought is, you can get people orderly into place at the beginning of the concert. Good luck at the end. Right? Everybody's smashed. Nobody cares, you know.
Well, the other part is if they are orderly at the end of the concert, then you suck.
I haven't done my job. I suck totally.
Exactly.
I'm listening to a podcast right now that Chuck D did about the Clash. It's a really good really good podcast.
Wow.
And yeah, that band was all about, you know, if there isn't some kind of riot, we just haven't done our job right.
Absolutely. We need a little bloodshed just to make sure.
Yeah.
For sure. Man, it is such a good thing. We've got this little batter's box thing that Dave does. I think he did it last time where he throws out a list of questions and then you just give one word association answers. Now, he fancies himself kind of a badass with this list, so please give him an Australian ass whooping if you would. We would appreciate that. So, Dave, you ready for batter's box?
I totally am. In fact, I want to make so sure I got it right. I'm gonna use my notes here. Harmonies.
Everly Brothers.
Ooh.
808.
Banjos.
Les Paul or Strat?
Yes.
guitar pedals.
Yeah. I've turned it into a yes or no answer, haven't I?
That's okay.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a place for those. There is. Yeah.
Favorite key, major or minor?
Major. Yeah.
Reverb.
Yep. Spring.
Post Malone.
Phenom.
Most annoying instrument.
Oh my God. What is the most annoying instrument? I don't know. You tell me.
Bagpipes.
Yeah, but when Bon Scott plays them, they're pretty badass.
Oh my gosh, that's so true. Mm-hmm. By the way, that was my mother's favorite instrument.
Well, you're off the Christmas list.
Live or programmed drums?
Oh, both. Both. And I use both a lot in the same song. Okay.
Mm-hmm. What was the cheapest piece of gear that you used on a song we might know?
Oh, gosh. I'm stumped right now. Cheapest piece of gear. I don't know if it's the cheapest piece of gear, but on this new album, there's a song called Better Than I Am. And there's when we were recording it over in London, I wanted to play a quick guitar solo just to get it down on the demo that I thought we were doing. Turned out that we were actually making the record. And Egg White, who I wrote it with, had this just piece of crap Telecaster copy hanging on the wall with these rusted strings, and I plugged it in and it was the worst sound. But I just kind of emoted out something on this guitar. And when I got back to America, I went, well, I'll fix that with a much better sounding guitar. And I could never capture the same spirit and emotion that was on the original. So I kept that crappy guitar on the version, on the record.
Love that. Love that. There's great athletes in Australia, and he kind of laid one on you, Dave, which is a good one. It's always
you got me, man.
For the people that can hear our voices, we tried to approach this with a no bias and removed, and the fact that Keith is cool enough to do our show, and it took about 5 minutes and we just turned into fans of a really, really good album. You guys have such issues because there are four or five singles on here that just jump out and slap you in the head. And that's a great, great problem.
Thank you.
No, I just certainly appreciate the work and appreciate your time. I know our audience loves to hear it from not just the horse's mouth, but somebody who relates to they do. When I listen to the lyrics, one of the things that in my notes that you spoke on is your albums maintain fun. And and the idea that this should be fun. But then the magic of super relatable lyrics to everyday people, all that is thought through and mixed in, but feels organic. So, Dave, as you get ready to take us home, Keith, we certainly appreciate you, man. We're here whenever you need us. We're here whenever you need us, and we certainly appreciate it. DP,
thank you, man.
I learned a lot reading about you this time because I went really deeper than I've ever gone before because I've always been a fan of yours. You've got a quote that says, the definition of humility is to remain teachable. And I started thinking and applying that to my own egotistical, arrogant self sometimes. And sometimes I'm hard, not teachable. And it moved me when I read that. And I think that because of you, I'm gonna try and get that humility back that I once had. It's hard when you're this good, but I'm going to really give it a try.
Oh, Lord, it's hard Hello. To be humble.
Thank you. All kidding aside, man, I really enjoyed the stories and the start, especially when you did chicken picking in a metal band, all those types of things. They just take me back to when I was, you know, touring around the world and stuff too. So thank you so much for everything. And we'll see you guys next week.
I love chatting with you guys always, Dave. And Herb, thank you so much, both of you, for all of everything. I mean, we need this portal right now.
And it's funny how folks are coming to it, you know, to be able to speak at scale around the world and be safe and be a brand that people trust. When you guys come on and validate it even further, what we find, which is a great unintended consequence, is the motivation that then we get back after they watch your show, the people are so inspired because they never thought they had a shot to hear right. you speak directly to them. So it's really cool.
I also like the fact that you guys are here because, you know, look, for me making records, it's collaborative and it's not just with the artist, it's with musicians, it's the engineers, it's the runners, it's the technicians. It's so many people that go into making a record and, you know, this is what you guys are all about. So I love doing this show for that reason.
Oh, no, we love having you.